Anybody have anything they want to say?
Yeah. Let's win this one for all the small schools who never had a chance to get here.
If you happen to pass through any small town in the state of Indiana, there's two things you're guaranteed to see. One is farming. And somewhere, in someone's driveway, barn, or backyard, basketball.
Thinking back to what the life of a farmer would be like, just, you know, that's something that I was raised, basketball, sports, and farming, that's about it.
Kent grew up as in a farm family. He was one of three boys. He was the middle child, and of all three boys, he loved farming. He was the one that was out there day and night with his dad and his mom farming.
Growing up in Jamestown, Indiana, Kent Poole encompassed every aspect of what it means to be a true Hoosier. From working on the farm and playing basketball, to landing a spot in one of the most influential sports movies of all time. From the outside, it was a life that appeared to be close to perfection. Inside, however, was a different story. Told through his wife, three children, the writer and director of Hoosiers, and a Hickory teammate. This is the story of Kent Poole.
Being able to get out in the field is like really finding a piece of my dad, being out there and remembering what it was like back years ago, being out in the field growing up, getting out of school, going straight to the field, falling asleep in the tractor, then going to basketball practice with him. That's about the routine, and then I'd get home from the field, and of course mom would make me do my homework. That wasn't quite as fun.
He always wanted to be a farmer and play sports, and that's what his childhood was, farming and sports. He then went to college and was there at Purdue for a year when he decided to come home and farm with his family. That was his love, and you know, he enjoyed that and excelled at that, and his dad retired and then he took over the family farm.
The life of a farmer is really during busy season, spring and harvest. You're out of the house and at the field before sun's up, and you don't get home until after dinner. So really, time flies when you're having fun, that's the saying. And really, when I get out in the field, it's like time really flies. You know, you put in 12-hour days, 13, 14-hour days, and it really feels like it's about 5 hours. Just that's how much fun it is just being out in the field and enjoying what I've grown up doing my whole life, really.
Along with the love of playing basketball, Kent also developed a love for coaching it.
He loved to coach. He coached 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th, and then he did girls varsity, was an assistant girls varsity coach too.
He always wanted all of us kids to be basketball stars, and I by far was the least athletic in our family.
Him being my coach growing up, 3rd and 4th grade, and also travel basketball, he was my coach growing up through that.
I think that was one of his joys, being around kids and helping them with athletics.
When he was the JV girls basketball coach at Western Boone here, I was just a little kid running around the gym, learning to dribble and getting up early in the mornings to go to their practice. You know, I probably was grouchy getting up that early, but once I got to the gym, it was something else.
From growing up in a small town and living a simple life, things changed dramatically for Kent when he was casted as Merle in the movie Hoosiers. Luckily for him, his role wasn't too far off of who he already was.
I think really Kent was
much like his role. He was a pretty serious guy.
I was in college and we were engaged at the time, and they were playing on the radio, come try out for this movie, Hoosiers. And I think he'd kind of been challenged by some friends, or he had said, I'm going to do it. And they're like, oh yeah, you go for it, you know, big time. And so I think he took it just as a challenge, you know, I'm just going to go prove them wrong.
We knew that the odds of finding really great basketball players that were actors probably pretty slim. As it turned out, we were totally right.
One of my favorite impromptu scenes in the movie was we were in the Knightstown gym, and had come down, and coach had told us to pass four times, and Kent's role was a little bit of, he was always on the coach's side. And my character, Raid Butcher, is I was always the antagonist and very much against Norman Dale. So Kent and I, as far as a role in the movie, we very much butted heads. And one of my favorite scenes is Kent impromptu, where I tell one of the players, he says, passes four times or you all are kicked off the team or don't come back Monday. And then Norman Dale and Hackman is kind of done with the scene, and I tell one of my players to shut up. And that in the 1950s would have been unacceptable, one. And Kent stepped in impromptu and turned right around and told me, no, Raid, you shut up. And that was not in the script. That was just us playing that out in real life. So I would say that, and not in a bad way, but I think that was a role that he took on, and that's really who Kent Poole was.
You know, he enjoyed being around the people, and just hoping that he would be able to land a spot in something he knew nothing about. He didn't know anything about Hollywood or filming or, you know, any of production part of being in a movie. So I think once he got around it, he really started hoping that it was going to work out for him.
One of the salient factors about the people in Milan, one of the important thing about the characters in this movie, is what they do. And most of them were farmers. And it was, I thought, very appealing that Kent not only came from a farming family and grew up in a farm, but he planned to take over his own farm. So he was our only true farmer that I remember. And there wasn't any kind of falsity about him. There was something so authentic about who he was.
That's the word, yeah.
And that he just felt right.
His role in the movie Hoosiers was casted perfectly. He was the kid from Western Boone. He was the kid from the small town. His line that was casted at the end of that movie in the locker room at Hinklefield House, when Gene Hackman looks around at all of us and he says,
anybody have anything they want to say?
And Kent pipes up.
Yeah. Let's win this one for all the small schools who never had a chance to get here.
That is Kent Poole. That was a perfect line. That is a legacy line for Kent Poole. It was perfect. No one else on our team could have delivered that line.
I find it really neat that he potentially had the most famous line in the movie Hoosiers, because it is known not only in Indiana sports, but also in other state sports, that he's able to make an impact on all those other kids' lives with his line that he had. And I know for me, it's kind of a cool factor because I have something to remember my dad by in a way that some people might not.
I had not been in communication with Kent, with the exception of of occasional reunions that we would have. And I just randomly ran into him in 2002 in Atlanta for when Indiana went there for the Final Four.
My dad probably struggled with depression for the last 5 years of his life. He made some pretty significant mistakes that were not true to his character and didn't align with his beliefs and the morals that he grew up knowing. And I think that it kind of consumed him, and it just ate him alive inside almost.
We end up talking for about 20 minutes outside before the afternoon game. And a couple things happened there. One was he told me that he was going through some things, and he was sweating a lot, and he looked pretty uptight and pretty stressed out.
I was aware in the sense of, you know, you hear things, not enough to ever take a step to approach Kent from that level, but as far as you hear things, yeah, I think all of us had heard some things. We knew he was struggling.
He asked for my phone number because he wanted to send me something. He had something that was really important that I sent him. So I gave him my address. So I gave him my address and I gave him my phone number. And I don't remember how long after that it was, but I got a phone call from him, and I didn't see who it was. I didn't recognize the number. I didn't pick it up. He left a message, and he said, "I really need your address. I lost it. I need to send you something." And I called him back immediately. I called back the number. He didn't pick up, and I left my address on his answering machine.
I don't think anybody knew how severe it was. I don't know that he even knew. But struggling, yes. Really, probably a lot darker than what any of us knew.
A week later, I heard that he had killed himself. And I went down to that post off my mailbox every single day, looking for something that would maybe help me understand what happened, because I never saw that coming. I had no idea at all. So I only found out afterwards, you know, the pain he was in and what he was going through, but I don't know what it was he wanted to send me.
The day was just kind of what I call ominous, you know, the dreary, kind of sad, depressing, shock, hard to believe that our life changed in an instant.
I think that it kind of made him feel like those mistakes identified who he was instead of the real, you know, Kent Poole that everybody knew. And that was really, really a struggle for him to know that people didn't hold him up on that pedestal that he'd always been on since the movie Hoosiers.
I personally had reached a point in my personal life where I had gone to the very, very depths of depression.
You know, mental depression is tough. I'm a doctor, and it's something I understand from a deep level. So mental issues, mental depression, issues of whatever demons that Kent might have been fighting, it's tough for anybody to know.
And I will say this, it was serious enough that I, for a brief moment in time, I had that taste on the tip of my tongue of what people like Kent tasted in their mouth. Obviously I'm speaking metaphorically, but I was lucky enough that I had a couple people in my life that literally came to my rescue and saved my life.
Like a lot of people know, you know, Satan gets you down at your weakest and darkest times, and that 100% happened to him.
And I've talked about it in other interviews, in print and whatever, and I'm not embarrassed or ashamed to talk about it, because if someone hears this or reads it, whatever that, and they can identify with that, and maybe it gives them the motivation to reach out and admit that this is bigger than them, you know, it may save someone else's life.
I think for people struggling with depression, as I kind of danced with it myself, I know that, you know, you just need to hold on to hope and know that there is something greater than this life, and things, you know, will get better, and you have people there to support you, and your mistakes don't define you, and there are ways to get out of it.
You know, I know that if I had had a chance to talk to him, it's emotional for me because I know where he was, you know, emotionally, and I wish to God there was some way that we could have explained to him that you don't have to live like this anymore. You really, there is a way out of this.
You know, life is hard with a lot of people, and you pick up the pieces and you move on, and as much as, you know, there's that loss and that void, still the kids have, you know, moved on and have accomplished great things, and a lot of credit goes to their dad too for who he was and how he raised them.
My dad was a very caring and generous man. He didn't know a stranger. He just embraced life and lived it to the fullest. He always loved to be busy and loved to reach out to others, and that's one gift that I hope all three of us kids can uphold or reflect from his personality and character.
I think my dad would say now his greatest gift that he ever had in life was us children.
Definitely his three kids, without a doubt.
100% his children. You know, he loved us kids more than anything.
Just watching him interact with them and putting them first in his life was a lot of good family memories.
I remember him being so serious most of the time, and very conscientious, and I mean, he listened to every word that anyone said, whether he was talking to Angelo about the character, or whether he was taking direction from me, or whether they were, you know, whatever scene they were doing, whatever business was being done, his focus and concentration was 100%. And you could tell that he cared so much about getting it right.
I think the important thing to understand about Kent Poole is he was a deep thinker. He was a passionate guy. He was intense. You know, he was a good basketball player. I never wanted him to think he was better than me, but he was awful good.
So, you know, thinking back to some of the memories I have of my dad is, you know, whether it be him picking me up from elementary school and going straight to the field, and whether he put me to work right away as a fifth grader or something like that in a tractor, or whether it was just sitting in the combine with him all day, you know, just listening to him talk on the radio and cell phone, or just watching the corn, things like that, that I would love to go back to.
There's one vacation I really remember, and just dancing with him on a boardwalk. I don't know why that's so significant to me, but it was such an awesome memory, and since I didn't get to dance with him at my wedding, I hold that close to my heart.
And in fact, when there was some horsing around, is that the way? Horseplay while we were shooting, it was often Kent who said, "Come on, guys."
Hey, you guys.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's the layers of Kent Poole. He was an awesome guy, good friend. Miss him a bunch, love his family. He's got a great family, and just because he's not here, he certainly does have a long legacy of the and proud accomplishments with the things he's done.
What I'd give to have him yell at me one more time on the basketball court You know, thinking back to the days where I thought, man, he's yelling a lot today. It'd be nice to hear him yell one more time.
This is the last shot that we got, all right? We're gonna run the picket fence at him. Merle, you're the swing man. Jimmy, you're solo right. All right, Merle should be open swinging around the end of that fence. Now, boys, don't get caught watching the paint dry. All right, take it!
There's a tradition in tournament play. Not talk about the next step until you climb the one in front of you. I'm sure going to the state finals is beyond your wildest dreams, so let's just keep it right there. Forget about the crowds, the size of the school, their fancy uniforms, and remember what got you here. Focus on the fundamentals that we've gone over time and time again, and most important, don't get caught up thinking about winning or losing this game. If you put your effort and concentration into playing to your potential to be the best that you can be, I don't care what the scoreboard says at the end of the game, in my book, we're gonna be winners. Okay?